closer to the facts, but that doesn't really sound very friendly, does it? So, a friend, that sounds about right. I mean, the word is friendly enough, though of course it is a little presumptuous when you really think about it. And after all, I don't know any of you, and you don't know me. I'm sure that if we got to know one another, we might very well be friends. But then again, I am monstrously tedious and very high maintenance. And some of you look very judgmental, so, I don't know. On such a short acquaintance, I think friends might be asking a lot. How about guests of you on stage?
Okay.
That, I think, should pretty much cover everyone. Of course, I can actually tell there are a few of you back there weren't invited. There are at least a dozen of you hanging out in the back who just wandered over wondering what the heck is going on here. So, how would I address you? Let me see. Family, friends, expectant strangers, curious onlookers, concerned citizens, unruly mob, drunken yahoos. Why don't we just go with dearly beloved? Alright, this is going to be a short ceremony as many of us want to grab a beer and a turkey leg and go see the joust and get some shopping done. So, please, fasten your seatbelts. We could experience some mild turbulence during this ceremony, so please keep your seatbacks up and your tray tables folded away. In the event of some unforeseen catastrophe, emergency exits can be found at the front, back, and sides of the audience seating. Should it become necessary, your seat acts as a flotation device. My seat is particularly buoyant, but it's none of your concern. If by any chance you experience a sudden drop in cabin pressure, a jester will descend from above and raise the pressure considerably. All right, before we go any further, and looking around at our couples, I'd say that they've all gone pretty far. I'd like to reflect on the concept of love and the practicalities of marriage. What is love? Love is many things, none of them logical. For centuries, poets, playwrights, philosophers have tried to put the experience of love into words. It motivates our most beautiful works of art and literature. It inspires symphonies, operas, and the entire country western music industry. Love is a line in your heart. You cannot describe it unless you've experienced it. And you cannot contain it with words. Everything before love is irrelevant, and nothing after is ever the same. True love is the best thing in the world, except for puppies. What is marriage? Marriage is a legal contract that clearly establishes your next of kin. Marriage, for most of recorded history, didn't concern itself with love. It was a business contract. It provided security and protection and heirs for property. Marriage created family alliances, which grew into dynasties and kingdoms and entire civilizations. No pressure. The concept of romantic love as a reason to get married is actually fairly new. Our society has advanced to the point where we can now listen to our hearts as a reliable guide to our life's purpose. Knowing that when we love, whomsoever we love, expresses divine intent and brings harm to no one. This is love's triumph and love's promise, that life together is immeasurably better than life alone. Now at this point, I would like to introduce Hail the Jester, who will present an alternative viewpoint on the state of marriage.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, Percival. And Percival, I have a small bone to pick with you.
Yes?
You did it to me again. You told me that this was a second cleavage contest.
Sorry.
Last year, you got me here by telling me it was a vow removal ceremony. Now, I know all of you, you look like very happy, happy couples. I myself am married. I have what I like to call a successful marriage. My wife and I, we're both in the entertainment business. We travel around the world separately. We see each other for about 15 minutes a year. And that is the secret to a successful marriage. For those who don't know, I am married to Percy's sister. That Percy's sister, that alone should have set off flares. She's a performance artist. And a natural blonde. So we don't get along that well. But I mean, I told her, I said to her, you know, dear, men are like wine. We get better with age. So she locked me in a cellar. But I want to tell you, my wife and I don't quite get along, but there is still something that keeps us together. So I wrote a song about it. And when I say wrote a song, I mean stole it from Cole Porter. When you first said, baby mine, let me be your Valentine, I assumed that phrase meant you gave your heart to me. I was sure you'd be so nice, just a parcel from paradise. But to my amazement, look what you turned out to be. You're the fly in my ointment, you're the frog in my throat, you're the knock in my engine, you're the leak in my boat, you're the bats in my belfry, you're the pebble in my shoe, you're the bull in my china shop, you're the mouse in my stew, you're the weed in my garden, you're the crack in my glass, you're the ache in my tummy, you're the pain in my, the hurricane in my super sensitive heart, dear. Still I love you, I know, and the reason is merely because you irritate me so. You fascinate me, you devastate me, because my dearie, you irritate me so. Thank you.
Well, what relationship doesn't have its little ups and downs? Well, generally at this point, there is a pretty song or some sentimentally sappy poem to enhance the mood. For the traditionalist, I've used Bible readings, either the Song of Solomon or Paul's letter to the Corinthians. I can certainly pull that out at a moment's notice. For the poetic, there are excerpts from the Bronze, the poet, prophet. Shakespeare, of course, offers us a ton of material and endless sonnets, but this reading from the poet and philosopher Hugh Anthony Clegg III seems most appropriate to this gathering. The power of love is a curious thing. Makes one man weep, make another man sing. Change a hawk to a little white dove. More than a feeling, that's the power of love. Tougher than diamonds, rich like cream, stronger and harder than a bad girl's dream. Make a bad one good, make a wrong one right. Power of love, that keeps you home at night. You don't need money, don't take fame, don't need no credit card to ride this train. It's strong and it's sudden and it's cruel sometimes, but it might just save your life. That's the power of love. That's the power of love. genuine sentiment. Establish that your love will never be blotted out by the common, nor obscured by the ordinary in life. Faults will surface where now you find comfort, and admiration can be shattered by the routine of daily life. When you love someone, you do not love them all the time in exactly the same way from moment to moment. That's impossible. It's even a disservice to pretend that it is possible. Yet, that is what most of us demand. We have such little faith in the ebb and flow of life, love, and relationships. We leap forward at the flow of the tide and resist in terror its ebb, for we are afraid it will never return. We insist on permanence, on duration, on continuity. But the only continuity possible in life, as in love, is in growth, in fluidity, and in freedom. As dancers are free, barely touching as they pass, but partners in creating the same pattern, and where one's happiness is measured only in the happiness of another. Couples, please face each other and repeat after me. My beloved, I promise you that I will be your companion from this day forward, to be faithful and honest in every way, to honor the faith and trust you place in me. I promise to love you and to respect you. I promise to make you laugh and to be there when you cry.
Hello, Erin.
To kiss you softly when you are hurting, and to share with you. Don't bother with that last part. And to share with you the unexpected wonders of the day. I promise to be your companion, your lover, and your friend. And now, couples, if you agree with this further statement, simply say, we do. After this next part, do you take this person before you in honor and respect to be your lawfully wed partner, to have and to hold from this day forward, in sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer, forsaking all others as long as you both shall live? I think we have an I love everyone. All right then. Ladies, yes, will you circulate these ribbons? We are going to be presenting you with something. Now that this vow has been your public declaration of love and commitment, ladies, I would ask you all to just place your hand out at about this height. Your right hand. We're going, gentlemen, place your hand lightly on top of the lady's hand. Excellent. And we will circulate around. Your Majesty, would you assist? Very good. Tina is helping. This is a hand fasting. In many European traditions, once the vows have been made, the hands of the bride and groom are tied together to reflect the idea that from this day forward, you are one. That marriage is a single entity made of two hearts, two minds, and two souls. The cord is red, representing life. The cord is wrapped loosely, for it does not bind, but rather it draws together two individuals, making them one, and reminding you both that forevermore you are together and must care for one another. It also serves to remind the gentlemen that this is the last time they shall have the upper hand. We have been a little lighthearted and hopefully serious as well. We want you all to know how seriously we do take these vows, this commitment to one another, this life you have shared and will continue to share for many, many years. And we leave this by saying that from my own wealth of experience, the secret to a happy marriage remains a secret. One couple remaining, I believe. There'll be no door to come to life. He's got a great sword. And she has exquisite jewelry. We owe you one. Haven't you got a collection going now? I believe so, everyone. Excellent. Then, by the power invested in me, by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and the authority of these witnesses, in the presence of all divine and mystical powers, both seen and unseen, I now pronounce you married again. There is no. That's my sacred proof. All right, friends. As you exit the stage one at a time to the thunderous applause of your friends, we have one final tradition that is called jumping the broom. A broom sweeps away all the accumulated clutter and discord of the past, making things clean and new again. And so does this symbol. As the couples jump or carefully step over the broom, they leave behind their fears, their anxieties, and their past, and step forward into their futures. They make a leap of faith and leave behind the people they were, and with one step begin the journey to becoming the people they were meant to. Dearly beloved friends or unruly mob of drunken yahoos, I present to you our brides and our grooms, our married couples. Three cheers! Hip hip!
Quick.
Here we go.
I loosely tied.
Stepping carefully, and there we go.
Across the room first.